some of these episodes explicitly reveal the Iron Age poet's understanding of the world axis as a pivotal mythological concept. As we'll see, individual instances of so-called axes mundorum throughout the text serve to juxtapose multiple worlds that each revolve around their own central pillar. Most notably, there are pillars central to the events in Utopian Phaeaca, and pillars central to the events in Odysseus' homeland Ithaca. So, let's first turn to the conception of sacred space as described by Mircea Eliade, so that we can later apply it to specific episodes in the Odyssey. Eliade proposed that inherent to all myth and ritual is what he called a distinct boundary situation. He explained that a boundary situation arises when a character, quote, discovers himself becoming conscious of his place in the universe. Let me say that again. It's a place where a character discovers himself becoming conscious of his place in the universe. That is, when he's in a place of self-revelation. This process of self-revelation, wherever it may occur, inevitably leads to one's awareness of the clear dichotomy between sacred space on the one hand and profane space on the other. Sacred space acts as a sort of microcosm to the external world. It is consciously delineated, it's set apart, and it's orderly. But outside of sacred space, there's a contrary world characterized by formlessness, chaos, and danger. So, in this cosmology, the world can be considered The specific words we're looking for in Greek are kion and stathmos, both of which are used interchangeably to mean roof pillar or column throughout the Odyssey. In addition to these instances, we'll look at the episodes in Book 6 wherein Odysseus compares the royal maiden Nausicaa, whom he believes might be a goddess, to a palm tree which he once saw growing next to an Apollonian altar on Delos. So, our very first appearance of the pillar motif in the Odyssey is a great example to demonstrate that the Iron Age Greeks not only associated the word kion with the concept of a world axis, but also simultaneously held to the concept of a world navel. Ne solenem fierite hoti tom phalos esti talases, ne sostendreis atea tento matanai. Antos jugeter olo phronos hoste talases passe vete aiden e che detecion assautos macras agai anteca uranonam secusi. That's from Book 1, line 50-54. On a seagirt island where stands the navel of the sea, on this forested island, a goddess makes her home, the daughter of malign Atlas, who knows the depths of every sea and by himself holds the tall pillars that hold apart heaven and earth. So, here, not only is the notion of a maritime center expressed with the word omphalos, but so too is the axis mundi motif expressed in its most elementary form. We are told that earth and heaven are held apart by the pillars, or the kionas, of Atlas himself. We see the transferable nature of the world's center here, and the potential for the multiplicity of centers arising in one single narrative. I think the main idea I'm trying to get across here is that the center of the world is not a fixed location, but it's rather subject to move depending on the focal point of the narrative. So passing through to our second instance of the world axis motif, we come to the island of Scheria, where Nausithous had led the Phaeacians to settle down away from the Cyclops. By this point, Odysseus had been battered about by the sea and wandering for 20 days, having escaped captivity from Calypso on Ogygia, at the aforementioned navel of the sea. Then, after he's unconsciously washed up onto the shore, Odysseus wakes up to the sound of young girls playing ball. Naked and encrusted with sea brine, Odysseus walks to a nearby thicket to get a leafy branch with which to cover his nudity. Here, he's spotted by Nausicaa, the daughter of the Phaeacian king Alcinous, and Odysseus is unsure whether he should address the girl at a distance or fall before her knees and beg for help. At this point, Odysseus is caught in a fatal dilemma. He's uncertain whether he's stumbled upon a bathing goddess or just a young girl of exceeding beauty. Odysseus asks her, "Are you God or mortal? If you are a god who holds wide heaven, I think you nearest to Artemis, great Zeus's daughter, in figure, form, and stature." This moment of doubt is offset, however, when Nausicaa's